players against us. They're not just in Northeast Afghanistan. They're in Afghanistan. They're in Pakistan. They're in Yemen. They're in Somalia. They're in Algeria. They're in Libya. They're in Iraq. They're in Syria. They're everywhere, spreading. That's what we get. It's called blowback by the CIA. And you can call it boomerang. It's boomeranging on us. We're creating and expanding the very thing we're fighting.
That's right.
Because we're not fighting it right. We're fighting it with brute force. We don't understand the people there. We don't understand their cultures. We don't understand their fears. We're insensitive to when we blow up their children. And our foreign policy has been one of brute force. It's been one where the first reaction is blow them up. And what's happening is, you now have more than tens of thousands of fighters. They're recruiting in Europe. They're recruiting all over the world. And they're getting more trained. They're getting smarter with weapons. They're getting better with the internet. We're training the very opposition. Now how could our leaders be this stupid? For two reasons. Profiteering is supreme. Very short-sighted. Profiteering, quick gratification. Hey, we blew up a truck with suspects. Very short-sighted. We don't pay our political leaders to have the myopia of a microbe suffocating under its own exudations. We pay them for foresight. We don't pay them for a cheap campaign contribution or a big paying job when they quit the government in Lockheed Martin or General Electric. The second reason for this stupidity, is rather obvious. They have no risk. Remember the saying in the 60s on the Vietnam War? If you're not part of the risk, you're not part of the solution. Members of Congress don't have any children in the armed forces, with one or two exceptions. You know, George W. Bush said Iraq was worth it. Well, hey, what about his two girls? Why didn't they sign up? Why didn't they go in the U.S. Army, Navy, Marines? They're age qualified. We have a political ruling class that wants poor whites, poor blacks, and poor Hispanics to go over there and do the dirty work for them because they can't find jobs here. Take those trillions of dollars and put them back in the U.S. Here's the kind of country we'll live in over the last 40 years. No one will die in the U.S. because they can't have health insurance to get diagnosed and treated in time. That's what Bernie Sanders said. Full Medicare for everybody, everybody in, nobody out, and free choice to doctor and hospital, which we don't have under the corporate system today. Here's what we have with those trillions of dollars. No tuition paid, free higher education. Just the way it is in Germany, France, Italy, Sweden, you name it, they do it. We won World War II, they were devastated. How come they have it? Because they mobilized. They had stronger trade unions, they had powerful cooperatives, and they went to work. They had higher expectations. How many of you remember the great leader in your history books, Eugene Debs? Right? Okay. At the end of his career, he said he was walking at a demonstration and a reporter came up to him. Mr. Debs, you've been at this for 50 years. Nobody has discouraged you. What's your greatest regret? And Mr. Debs said, looking at him, he said, my greatest regret, young man, my greatest regret, this is in the 1920s, my greatest regret is that the American people, under their Constitution, can have almost anything they want, but they don't seem to want much of anything at all.
Bravo.
Raise our expectations. Yeah. That's the first step toward a just democracy. trillions of dollars it paid for. That would have raised the wages of tens of millions of Americans who can't put food on the table because of a frozen minimum wage. They would have provided repairs and good-paying jobs that can't be exported to China, to rebuild our infrastructure, our public facilities in every town, village, city. It's crumbling. You see it's crumbling. Look at our schools. We got glittering gambling casinos and crumbling schools because we're an empire. The money is going over there. The money is going into the military budget. Half of our federal budget, aside from Medicare, Medicaid, half of the budget is military. We don't have the Soviet Union anymore. We don't have Communist China threatening us. They want our business, our jobs, our industries, and we're obliging them. They're happy. That's what we have to do, raise our expectation level. And to do that, we have to have our own self-respect as citizens. We cannot go around making excuses for ourselves. Here's the ones we've all heard, right?
That's right.
You call up people, hey, you know, there's something going on in Kingston, and can you show up for the city council meeting? Can you go to a rally? Can you join a demonstration in New York City against the war? Well, I agree with you, but I just don't have time. I really don't have time. Well, if you don't have time for democracy, you're going to be very busy with your misery.
Exactly.
That's what happens.
Make the time.
And so here's an interesting story that relates to all of us. The former head of the Tennessee Valley Authority, which is a publicly owned electric generating distribution system in Tennessee Valley. It was a great godsend to him in the 30s because they had no electricity. Millions of poor people. And the head of it resigned in the 1930s. His name was Arthur Morgan. Why did he resign? Because he wanted to go all over the world to answer the question, what does it take to make social change? What does it take to advance social justice? And he went everywhere. He went to South America, Africa, Asia, Europe, North America, everywhere. And he came back with his answer. And his answer was the title of his little book that came out in 1940. And the answer was the small community. Everything starts with the small community. Everything starts with the living room session. Everything starts with two people replacing small talk with big talk. So when you meet someone, the usual is, hi, how are you? Good, even though you're lying. Like you got the flu. You okay? Yeah. How are things? Okay. How about a new salutation? Next time you meet people, you say, hi, how's your civic life? What's your reaction?
I don't even know what it is.
Huh? Well, starts a conversation, right? Once people, 2, 4, 8, 16, 20, things start, then they spread. That's how the peace movement started in the 1960s. That's how the new one started in the 1980s by Fosberg out of Boston. They changed things. Now, as we speak, there are Russian nuclear weapon inspectors in the U.S. looking over the, in effect, the destruction of nuclear warheads, and U.S. inspectors in Russia observing the destruction of nuclear warheads in Russia, and we have, in effect, disabled half of the missiles that the U.S. and the Soviet Union had ready to go after each other. Now, that wouldn't have happened without small communities. It didn't happen in Congress. It didn't happen in the White House. When Ronald Reagan looked on the evening TV and he saw the huge rallies in New York City, he turned to one of his aides and he says, well, they look like some pretty well-dressed Republicans there. It changed the government. It doesn't take that much. It's easier than you think. It's easier than you think, and we've proved it again and again. American history has been changed by less than 1% of seriously engaged citizens representing silent majority public opinion. Those are the two things you need. Those are the two things you need. Now here, I've never done this before. I've never asked people to repeat something. But I gotta have you do this for me. Indulge me. It's easier than we think to turn the country around.
It's easier.
It's easier than we think to turn the country around. We did it with less than 0.1% for the auto industry. Others in the environmental groups got the Air and Water Pollution Control Act. There wasn't more than 50,000 seriously engaged people working on their members of Congress. There are only 535 members of Congress. They put their shoes on every day the way you and I do. There are 1,500 or so companies who spend a lot of time on Congress to get their way with the majority of Congress. How many of us are doing that? Almost none. So if you're fielding your football team against Notre Dame, and Notre Dame comes on with 11 players, and you come on with one player leaning on a cane, who's going to win? Okay, that's the scene in America today. We have given up on ourselves before we have even started to struggle, with very, very few exceptions. Now here's what I'd like you to do. A very simple bill can stop most of the wars that we get into. Criminal wars of aggression. Here's the bill. Anytime Congress or the White House is ready to plunge our country into war, the moment that decision is made, every able-bodied, age-qualified child and grandchild of every member of Congress will immediately be drafted into the armed service. That will, shall we say, induce deliberation by our political leaders, won't it? They will decide to have hearings where all kinds of opinions are expressed, including by the retired military that often represents some of the best peace advocates. They will return your calls. They will decide to give interviews other than warmongering. Yeah. Send the poor folk over there due to killing. It's not us. It will work like magic. And they're going to fight that bill, even though it doesn't cost the taxpayer anything. But what a wonderful fight to have, huh? Imagine them coming back for the town meeting. Okay, are you for HR 5? HR 5, HR 5. You're going nowhere without voting for HR 5. We'll be very happy to work on the specific drafting so there are no loopholes to that congressional draft. Okay? That is what gets people talking. Because most people have a sense of fair play, don't they? They may be conservative, liberal, so on. They have a sense of fair play. They can be conservative, liberal, someone comes around and pushes an older people in the middle of the road to go to the cross. That's not right. It's deep in us. And once we have this kind of bill, changes the whole dynamic of the conversation. The second thing we should do is to ask ourselves, what are all these wars of aggression doing to them overseas? They're real people too. They have children too. Pictures are not enough. What is it doing to them? And it's being done to them in our name. That violence is being done to them in our name, as Cindy Sheehan has pointed out, all over the country. It's being done in our name. We should take it personally and reject it unless we consent to it in a national referendum. Then I mentioned what it's doing to us. Look at our civil liberties. How many people you know don't speak up because they're afraid of being some computer file? They don't have to be afraid anymore. We're all in the computer file now. The NSA has dragnet snooped everybody. Emails, telephone numbers. They say that they're not using them. They say it's all in the computer bank. Well, that's really comforting, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
The minute you speak out, then they start using it. The minute you demonstrate, they start using it. But the more there is of us, the less it means anything. They can use it all they want. As long as they get more and more Americans say, you're not going to snoop on us anymore. You're not going to invade our privacy. You're not going to inhibit our freedoms and our liberty. Empire destroys freedom and liberty. Never allow these war hawks to say that they're sending soldiers over there to protect our freedoms. They're sending soldiers over there in a criminal war to kill and die. That's what they're selling soldiers over there, and blow back against our freedom. That is why we need to talk to the returning veterans, not just the ones that have stood up, the Veterans for Peace, Iraq veterans against the war, but the ones who've seen horrible things and are traumatized. You know all the soldiers who are traumatized, people think, well, that's because of the artillery shells and the bombs. Well, the other side, they don't have any artillery shells and fighter planes or naval missiles. They've got suicide belts and Kalashnikovs and maybe some propelled grenades. You know why a lot of these soldiers are under traumatic stress syndrome?
Moral.
It's amazing how few people know that. It's moral. Stress syndrome.
That's right.
They have been ordered to kill innocent people and families. And it's on their minds all the time. And the psychologists in the military have demonstrated that it is morally induced more than not.
That's right.
Okay, now we've got two other things. We got to join the arms control movement, the Congress, the warmongering Congress, especially the Republicans, who I think are institutionally insane, I think by any criteria. The Congress, we got to develop this concept of institutional insanity.
Yeah.
Like I have often said, General Motors refused to toilet train itself for 50 years,
yeah,
choking our lungs with pollution.
That's right.
Institutionally insane.
That's right.
You know those drug companies who push pregnant women through hospitals, deliver their babies, they want them out in 30 hours? Attention deficit disorder. Yeah, these hospitals have a mental problem.
Yep.
Well, we've got an institutionally insane series of behavior by our government.
Yep.
And they have to be shaken up by a sane citizenship.
We need an intervention.
And we definitely have got to join the existing arms control movements to speed up the enforcement of the treaties that already exist between the U.S. and the Soviet and Russia now, and the international arms control treaties of long standing. They need to be implemented. Final thing I think you'll all agree with, we need a special independent tribunal by the Justice Department to prosecute the war criminals, starting with George W. Bush and Dick Cheney.
Yeah.
There are some great full-page ads in the New York Times by The World Can't Wait.
Yeah!
Isn't that a great group?
Yeah, Ralph! Yeah.
Those are very powerful and incisive advertisements.
Amen.
We had the Nuremberg trials. The Nuremberg trials against the Nazi leaders, the prosecution was run by Supreme Court Justice on leave, Justice Jackson. And what he said in his opening statement, mind you, there are 20 Nazi criminals in the dock, and the tribunal judges, Nuremberg, Germany, just think, we could have immediately executed them. We wanted to establish international law that it is not an excuse to slaughter thousands and millions of innocent people because they gave you an order.
We would have never had a Bush if it hadn't been for you.
Because they didn't follow order. And what he said was, the precedents coming out of this Nuremberg War Tribunal is going to apply to everybody in the world, including us. That's what he said. And what we've got to do is stop saying to the International Criminal Court, hey, go after those African dictators, but don't go after white dictators or Western dictators and prosecute them in The Hague, in the Netherlands. And so the important thing here is to follow your conscience. Do not go for the least of the worst of the candidates. Don't be fact deprived, as this gentleman elaborated so well with his comment just now, that we all have a right, equal right to run for election, local, state, and national, that we don't have an obligation to elect warmongering Republicans or warmongering Democrats, whether they are named Clinton or other warmongering leaders, presumed leaders. And that holds true for members of Congress and your own state legislature. If you don't vote for who do you believe in, who are you going to vote for? The least of the worst, the lesser of two evils, are still evil. And you then strengthen them, lose your bargaining power over them, and enable them to become even worse because they know they have you in their back pocket with the least worst voting attitude.
You lose your leverage.
Talk about Bernie, Ralph. What about Bernie?
No.
Say something about Bernie.
No. There's a lot to say, and there are others who have said it. No. There are two little pithy statements that we should all keep with us. One was out of the 14th century China. The Ming Dynasty, a philosopher, said the following: to know and not to do is not to know.
I'll do whatever the hell I want.
So we have the moral imperative of what we know that should be done, but how well do we know it if we don't move into action? To know and not to do is not to know. 14th century. I wonder how he thought of that without the internet, without email. The other definition is one of real vintage. Over 2,000 years ago, Marcus Cicero, an ancient Rome leader, elected figure, he said that, you know how many times right-wing politicians throw liberty and freedom in your face? Do you ever hear him talk justice, by the way? I once had the task to read all of Ronald Reagan's presidential speeches. Talk about masochism. He mentioned freedom and liberty dozens and dozens of times, never mentioned justice. Without justice, there's no freedom and liberty. Justice means bringing down the top 1%, holding them accountable. Justice means people receiving the wealth they've worked for and not having it sucked up to the top 1%. And here is his definition of freedom. These people are very pithy. Even though they didn't live in a soundbite TV period. Marcus Cicero said the following, quote, freedom is participation in power, end quote. That's the definition of freedom that we should operate on. Oh, the voice of the people, by and for the people in reality. Less than 1% of the people engaged 200 to 400 hours a year, spread out over the year, starting full-time groups in each congressional district. Less than 1% of the people, say 250,000 people, out of 330 million, no big deal. You know how many watch the Super Bowl? Can turn this country around on the issues of peace and war. And war and peace. And that should give us great optimism and great heart. And those 250,000 people reflecting the silent majority out there, they were against the Iraq War, even though they were propagandized by both parties and the media. Can you imagine that? Came in over 50%. They knew what was going on. And if they were more informed, more would have joined that 50%+. You know what makes up those 250,000 people? You, in small communities.